A long, long time ago in ancient China lived a nightingale of great renown. At night, in one of the highest trees in the forest, he would sing a most beautiful song, which carried on the night breeze and could be heard by nearly all around. His song was so beautiful that fishermen out at sea would put down their nets and turn to listen, enchanted by its sound. On one side of the forest stood the emperor's palace, with its vast and magnificent gardens, which ran all the way down to the sea. 100 gardeners worked constantly, tending 1,000 different flowers that grew there, and on which they hung tiny silver bells that made tinkling sounds in the breeze. However, as fabulous as the emperor's gardens were, the high walls that surrounded them had kept the nightingale's song from his ears. But the story of the wondrous nightingale spread throughout the land, and one day, quite by chance, the emperor happened to hear it. He called for his chamberlain.
That nightingale they're all talking about. Get someone to go out and find it and bring it back here. I want to hear its song, and I want to hear it tonight.
The chamberlain had no idea what the emperor was talking about.
A nightingale, you say, sire? I don't think I've ever heard of it. Nevertheless, I shall go and investigate.
The chamberlain first asked all the people in the palace whether they had ever heard the nightingale or knew where it could be found. Although familiar with the story, no one had ever heard or seen the bird at all. So the chamberlain returned to the emperor.
Sire, I've asked everyone in the palace, but no one's ever seen or heard this bird. Are you sure it exists?
Yes, yes, of course I'm sure. I know for a fact that even the townspeople have heard it. Go and continue your search, and make sure you bring it back here by nightfall.
The emperor had given the chamberlain an idea, and he made off in the direction of the imperial kitchen. The chamberlain's job was to look after the emperor's household, and he knew that one of the kitchen maids often made visits to her family that lived beyond the palace walls. He arrived at the kitchens and questioned the girl about the bird. As luck would have it, she had not only heard it sing, but knew exactly where to find it.
Oh, yeah, wonderful news. Do we must leave immediately if we're to bring it back by nightfall? Yeah, now come, leave what you're doing, make haste.
The chamberlain and the kitchen maid left the palace. They had been travelling for a little while, when in the distance, a cow began to moo. The chamberlain stopped in his tracks and listened intently.
Listen, there it is. What a beautiful sound that nightingale makes.
The kitchen maid looked at him with great surprise.
But chamberlain, that isn't a nightingale, it's a cow.
The chamberlain's cheeks burned with embarrassment at his stupid mistake, and they walked on in silence. Some way further on the road, they were passing a pond when a frog started to croak. The chamberlain stopped at once and cried out,
That's it! At last! Oh, dear, what a fine melody! This must be the nightingale!
The kitchen maid burst out laughing.
That's just a frog, chamberlain! An ordinary frog! A nightingale's song is far more beautiful than that!
Before the chamberlain could embarrass himself any further, from a nearby tree came the unmistakable sound of the nightingale's song. As they approached the tree, the kitchen maid called up to the nightingale and told him that the emperor would very much like to hear him sing in the palace that night. The nightingale accepted the invitation and returned with them to the palace. That night, a golden stand was placed before the emperor's throne. The nightingale perched on the stand, and when the emperor and the palace household had gathered around it, the bird began to sing. The crowd listened in complete silence as the exquisite and moving song of the nightingale gently echoed around the great hall. Not until the last faint echoes of the bird's song had died away did anyone even murmur or move a muscle. And then the emperor, wiping a tear from his eye, decreed that the nightingale should remain in the palace. He was so moved by its singing that he wanted to hear its song every night. The bird was placed in the care of specially selected servants who were ordered to grant its every wish and ensure its complete happiness. And so the nightingale stayed at the palace, and each knight gave a superb performance. One day, a large unmarked parcel was delivered to the palace. Eager to know what was inside, the emperor hastily removed the wrappings to reveal a large imitation nightingale. The feathers were made of silk, and the eyes were large precious stones. A key turned in the back of the mechanical bird, and if wound, the bird would sing. The emperor, who had a passion for machines and gadgets, was fascinated. And that night, in the great hall, he placed the mechanical bird next to the real nightingale and listened as they sang together. However, the sound they made was far from pleasing. The puzzled emperor called for his imperial musicians and asked them what the problem could be. As far as they were concerned, the problem must be with the mechanical bird, as they'd all heard the beautiful song of the real nightingale, which they felt was faultless. But the emperor wanted a second opinion and decided to call the imperial clockmaker, who often built small mechanical toys for the emperor's children, and sometimes the emperor himself. The clockmaker was also fascinated by the mechanical bird and longed to know how it worked. He examined the bird with great excitement.
Truly a marvel, very, very interesting. Yes, sire, it is my considered opinion that as this machine is so finely built, with such a precise mechanism, the fault must lie entirely with the real bird, who I fancy cannot sing in time.
The emperor scratched his chin and stared at the two birds.
Well, let's hear the mechanical bird sing alone, and I will judge its performance.
Not only could the mechanical bird sing in perfect time, but, unlike the real bird, it could also repeat the same song over and over again. Some of the palace household said that they actually preferred the look of the mechanical bird with its jeweled eyes and fancy feathers. And whilst everyone was crowded around it in admiration, the real nightingale flew from its perch, through the open window, over the palace walls and back into the forest. The emperor wasn't much bothered that the nightingale had flown away. The clockmaker had assured him that the imitation was the better singer. It could sing the same song 100 times without changing a note. The real one couldn't do that because it invented new songs all the time, never singing the same melody twice. The emperor was so proud of this new toy that he wanted to show it off to all his subjects. The mechanical bird was placed on a red silk cushion and carried through the streets of the city by the emperor's footmen, so that all could hear its song. Everyone who heard the bird thought it marvellous, and after a year, everyone in China knew its song off by heart. It now lived on a table beside the emperor's canopied bed, and one evening, as it sang for him, something awful happened. In the middle of its song, a rattling sound came from inside the bird. And seconds later, it stopped singing altogether. The emperor, shocked and disappointed, called for the imperial clockmaker.
Clockmaker, something is wrong with the bird. It will not sing anymore. Fix it as soon as you can. I am lost without its song.
The clockmaker carefully picked up the bird and took it off to his workshop, where he worked on the repair all through the night and most of the next day. As evening approached, he arrived back at the emperor's chambers.
Sire, I have done the best I can to mend the bird, but the mechanics are very, very complicated and are beginning to wear badly. From now on, you'll have to be especially careful with it. Constant use will certainly shorten its life.
The emperor let the bird sing on just one day in every year. On each occasion, the bird would be placed in the great hall and the imperial clockmaker would arrive with its key. Before winding its mechanism, he would read out a speech proclaiming that the bird could sing as well as ever. Many years went by, and as the emperor grew older, his health began to fail. One day, he fell so ill that the imperial physician feared that he wouldn't live much longer. The emperor lay in his bed feeling sorrowful. It looked as though death would come soon and claim him. The moonlight shone through the open window and onto the mechanical bird still standing by the emperor's bedside. The emperor looked at it and begged.
Please, bird, sing for me once more. I have always treated you very well and given you everything you desired, couldn't you sing for me just one more time? Please, won't you?
But the bird remained silent. The emperor felt even more miserable, and a tear rolled down his cheek. Suddenly, a little bird landed on the sill of the open window. It was the real nightingale. It had heard that the emperor was close to death and had come to sing for him one more time. As the bird sang, the emperor opened his eyes and turned his head towards the window. His pulse became stronger and he began to feel a little better. Maybe the melody didn't follow a regular beat, but it sounded pure and natural. As the bird finished its song, the emperor propped himself up on one elbow.
Please, don't leave. Sing me another of your songs.
The nightingale began another song. The emperor began to feel even better, and the colour started returning to his cheeks. He sat up, arranged his pillows, and leant back and listened as the bird sang. Tears of joy replaced his tears of sorrow. The emperor was very grateful.
Thank you. Thank you, dear bird. I know I have treated you badly. I let a foolish imitation take your place, yet you have come back to me. How will I ever be able to thank you?
You've already done that, sire. As I sang for you, I saw the tears in your eyes, and there could not have been a better reward. Sleep is now what you need, and I'll sing you the most beautiful lullaby I know.
The bird sang until the emperor fell asleep. The following morning, the emperor awoke with the sun streaming through the window, where the nightingale still perched singing its song. The emperor felt completely recovered and was glad to be alive. He spoke to the bird.
Nightingale, please, will you stay and sing for me every day?
I'm afraid that I can't, sire. There are many others to whom I must sing my song. The woodcutters in the forest, the fishermen at sea, the farmers in their fields. But what I can promise is that every evening I will come to the palace wall and sing you one song.
The emperor thanked the nightingale and watched as it flew from the window, over the palace wall, and back into the forest. Just then, the door quietly opened, and in tiptoed the chamberlain. Half expecting to find that the emperor had died during the night, he gasped with surprise to see him standing by the window, fit and well. The emperor looked at the chamberlain and chuckled.
No, chamberlain, I am not dead yet, and I am not planning to die for a long, long time.